So we have begun the season of Advent. I'm going to read for you from the prophet Isaiah, who is talking about the things that are to come. This is Isaiah chapter 64, verses 1 through 9, I think. Right? Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood, and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you who works for them who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned because you hid yourself. We transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We fade like a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So, as we begin this season of waiting, the waiting for the coming of Christ, with the words of the prophet Isaiah, who reminds us why we need a Messiah, why we needed a Savior in the first place. He names our brokenness. He names our lostness and our longing as well. We want that Savior to come back. And Scripture tells us Jesus is going to return again. None of us knows when. That's why we wait and we watch. So that the Advent candle reminds us of this waiting and this watching and marking time and preparing. And as we're preparing our homes, we also have to prepare our hearts. Who among us here today doesn't wish for an end to suffering and oppression and injustice? So many people this week were very disappointed that Michael Brown's death was not avenged. It seemed an injustice that the officer faced no punishment, and yet the system that is in place, our laws, the laws under which we live, stated that he had acted within the boundaries of that law. The injustice is that the law, any law, cannot properly determine our human reactions. It sets limits, and yet we find ourselves mourning. We grieve with his family. We rally against the results because we know that even within the boundaries of the law, there is brokenness. We are left with loss and anger, finding children being shot down in the prime of life before they've even grown into maturity because of brokenness. We are still a broken people. We still need God's forgiveness. We still need to be transformed. We need that transformation of our hearts. When we say our mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world, that's what we're talking about. Transforming every human heart to God's will, to make us all the people of God that live according to the will of our Creator. This longing for redemption of humanity is as real now as it was 2014 years ago, or 2010, depending on whose calendar you use. The joy of the season of preparation as we prepare for the birth of Christ comes out of the anticipation of the fact that we know, at least we have this vision, for what is possible based on what Jesus told us, what to expect out of the world and God's heavenly kingdom coming to fruition. So we envision something better for our world. And in the meantime, we wait and we hope. Today's Advent candle was the candle of hope. Out of the darkness in our broken world, we know that we can light a single candle, and that that light, that single candlelight, can cast light into the whole realm. The light, if you light a candle in the dark, total darkness of a cave, the whole cave becomes lit up, with the exception of anything in the shadows. The shadow of a stalactite or a stalagmite, there's going to be some darkness. So even in our world, when the light of Christ is shining, there are still shadows where the light of Christ is blocked. Now, shadows can be scary things. Along with those things that go bump in the night, the shadows of what might be in the darkness is legend. You know, whole movies are built out of what's in the darkness. And it plays on our fears. We fear what we cannot see clearly, what we wonder, whether it's the shadow in an X-ray or the shadow of darkness. We fear. We shrink back and look for something or someone to protect us, to hold on to us, to guard us from harm. But in fear, we react rather than reason. If we're always in a perpetual state of fear, then we don't reason through all of the possibilities of what we might do instead of striking out. That's why Jesus told us we should fear not. Fear not. Now, shadows are not necessarily bad things. There are multiple references in Scripture, especially in the Psalms, where we find the words, under the shadow of thy wings. We even just sang that about being in the shadow of the wings. What a wonderful place to be, protected under the shadow of an angel's wings or our guardian angel's wings. Growing up, I had this little picture above my bed that was the guardian angel watching the two little kids walk across the bridge. You ever seen that one? Yeah, just the image of being protected, cared for, guarded. And then there's the other scripture words that say, in the shadow from the heat, which to you and I would mean being under the shade of something, protected by the shade. To be in the shade of a large tree on a very hot day brings a wonderful image of protection and coolness, giving us a positive image for what it is to live under the shadow of God's protection. Now, the shadow of doubt, that can be either good or bad. If I'm an innocent person on trial and the jury has reasonable doubt of my guilt, then that's a very good thing for me, because that means they're not going to find me guilty. That's a good thing. But if I'm a person living constantly in the shadow of doubt as to whether or not I'm worthy of God's love and God's grace, then that's not. That kind of shadow keeps a person from realizing the depth of God's love for them. The kind of love that God caused God to come down to earth, to be born in human form, for the sake of walking among us, showing us, revealing to us the true nature of God, and to what extreme God would go in order that we could be saved. Now, the law had been given, and God saw that humans were broken. Our sinfulness kept us from ever being able to fulfill the law to the degree that we could be made holy. Jesus railed against the scribes and Pharisees, the keepers of the law, who would abide by the literalness of it, and yet behind the scenes, they would go against the original intent of the law. So God had to find another way. That's why he sent us Jesus. So this is what we celebrate in this season of preparation. This is why this season brings us so much joy. Retailers will try and tell you that it's the presents that we buy and put under the tree that brings great joy. And yeah, it's fun to buy presents for people we know and love. And there's a great anticipation in that. But once the presents are opened and we find that the little ones are playing with the box rather than the gift that was in it, you know, once that's all done and we have to take down the decorations, do you ever feel that let down? I sure do. You know, putting up decorations is fun. But then in 5 more weeks, when it's time to take them down, it's like, oh, here's that let down. That's why we have to remember what Christmas is really about. It's not about the presents at all. It's about the greatest gift, Jesus. That's why we celebrate Christmas. The true reason for our hope is Jesus Christ. Now, if you're one of those people that find yourself doubting God's love for you, I would invite you to light a candle. Now, if you're a person who tends to light a candle and forget that it's lit and it melts all over the place, and yeah, okay, set a little timer. Have that timer on to ding when it's time to blow the candle out. But I would invite you to light a candle and place that candle before you. Kind of meditate on it. Look at the candle and feel its warmth. Don't burn yourself. Don't light anything on fire, but feel its warmth. Notice its glow and the way the flame moves as if it's alive. And then look deep into the base of the flame. When you look at a flame, yeah, it's kind of whitish yellow up here, but when you get down to the very bottom, that's where it's hottest. Look at the blue base of the flame. And remember the power of God that can burn away all sin, all doubt, all guilt. And take a moment to pray, to ask God to remove anything in you, anything in your life that stands between you and God. Ask the Lord to just melt it away. Let it be like ice put before that flame. And it's gone. Ask God to do that for you, knowing that God hears your prayers. Now, don't ask for $1 million. That's a test to God. And Jesus said, don't test the Lord your God. But ask in words that feel normal to you. Church people growing up in church hear a lot of churchy language. Prayers don't have to be that. They can be as simple as, hey, God, I'm worried. I'm scared. And I don't know what to do. But I trust that you do. It can be simple as that. Just laying it out there. And God will hear you. And ask God to be at work in your life, helping you to be the person that God created you to be. Watch that flame dance as the air currents kind of wave it around. And imagine that you're dancing with joy as you look at that flame, because you no longer feel pain or fear or oppression or guilt. Dance with joy at the possibility that someday, someday, all of humankind will live together in peace. Believe that that is possible as we live together in the light of God's grace, because at that point in time, we will be freed from sin. Some people would name this as heaven. I prefer to believe Jesus when he said, it's already here. The beginnings of it are already here. So if we pray and we nurture that and we believe in the power of our risen Lord, then we know that it's true. Because of Jesus' coming, we'll know that we no longer live under the rule of fear and want. We have so much to look forward to. no longer wondering what's in the shadows that's going to harm us or control us. No longer feeling like we need to arm ourselves against all of that. But freed to live in the light of faith, under the shadow of the wings that guard us from evil. The evil that keeps us in a constant reactive state of anxiety and hatred and fear. We can live faithfully knowing that we are beloved children of God who no longer need to fear even death because Jesus showed us that death is no longer the end. Death no longer holds a sword over us. There's no sting in it because we know that something more awaits us. We live as the children of the light, placing our hope in the one who comes to us in pure, powerless innocence, a baby, pure love. As we prepare for Christmas in these next 4 weeks, we need to prepare our hearts as well as our homes. Take time to look deep into that candlelight. Take time to look deep into yourself and to surrender to God anything and everything that stands in the way of feeling the depth of the love that God has for you. He's your Heavenly Father. He loves you. Realizing that sometimes we do things that we regret. Sometimes they're accidental, shutting the door on someone's foot. But sometimes they're worse. We're human. We make mistakes. God knows